All right. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining and for sending all of those answers in. Very, very helpful. So we're going to get started now. And this is about creating the perfect internal AR strategy. So thank you again for everyone for joining us today. Looking forward to going through all this with you. I'm Daniel Hartz. I'm the one with the American accent. That's me on the left. I'm the customer success manager for Zapper.
And hi, everybody. My name is Martin Stahl. I'm the sales director at Zapper. And great to see such a global audience. Welcome.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. It's cool to see that we're all here from all over the place. So today we're going to be talking about really what you need to think about when you're creating an augmented reality strategy. There is a lot to keep in mind. It's a new medium for many people and for many companies. So it's important to really consider several different things. So some of the stuff that we're going to touch on and look at are, you know, related to what the capabilities of AR are, the industry, and perhaps we might touch a little bit on internal teams later in the questions. We're going to look at your AR roadmap, how to think about objectives and success, and which tools are right for you. And there's a lot of other fantastic content we'll be looking at during the next 45 minutes to an hour or so. We will have time for questions at the end, so please do send those to us. We certainly want to make sure that all of your questions are answered. There's perhaps a couple of different kinds of people who are joining us today. Some might be more marketing focused, some might be more learning and development focused. The reason why I want to mention this now is because some examples or some things that we mention or talk about might lean more to one or the other. Overall, the concepts and ideas that we're talking about are really quite universal and global. So it's really okay to take the things that we're talking about from one and apply it to the other. So please feel free to pay full attention, even if we're talking about something that may not directly be related to your industry. The concepts do go to both sides. So on that note, we'll start with talking a little bit about our background.
So hi again, everybody. It's Martin here. And to start off, we'll just give a quick introduction to who Zapper are. And we're a world-leading creative consultancy and platform rolled into one. And Zapper was launched just over 10 years ago. And our objective was to democratize this new technology called AR and to help our partners create short-form bits of infotainment and then deliver that to the user's smartphone or devices. And when we launched, there was nothing on the market. We really started from scratch and created from the ground up a content authoring platform that was specifically designed to help us create, as I mentioned, that short form bits of infotainment. And that's 1 to 2 minutes of good quality content that can be quickly and easily downloaded and played on the vast majority of Apple or iOS and Android devices on the market. And after 10 years of sweat and tears, we were in a position to open that up to the developer community and allow our partners to make their own content. And as it happens in the real world, there's no, black and white. And we work with a lot of our partners in a hybrid solution where they build their own content and they can still lean on the Zapper Studio to make the content for them when they either run out of time or the skill set. And each, I suppose, balance of each of those is dependent on the client themselves. And before we jump into the world of AR, it's really important to just understand its position in the world that we live in. And not so long ago, when we were allowed to go out and enjoy ourselves in big groups of people, we could see that we are all connected. We are all hardware enabled. And the smartphone itself has become that lifestyle appendage that we use to entertain ourselves, research, sort out our finance, sort out our holidays. And more importantly, we are using the camera of our devices to look at the world around us. And increasingly, there are multiple platforms out there that are teaching us to scan the world to unlock hidden content. And that's where the importance of AR comes in. And if we look at the next slide, harping back to the days when we were allowed out, our obsession with those are really highlighted by this A-frame, which suggests that if we went into a coffee shop and we didn't sit there on our phone, our tablet, or our laptop, people would look at us like we were a psychopath. Being disconnected is just a really weird thing. But it just puts that importance into perspective. And the marketing community are more and more trying to find ways of connecting with us on our smartphones and our devices. And especially when it comes to products and our own marketing, we have that owned media through which we can activate this hidden content. So if we move on to the next slide. And while the Zapper team are lucky to see what we call the Zapper rush, that look of amazement and excitement in the user's face when we demo the content, we really wanted to understand the science behind it. What was happening to create that level of excitement and engagement? And we teamed up with a company called NeuroInsight and the advertising agency Mindshare to do a scientific study into the impact on the brain of augmented reality compared to traditional media channels such as print, online, and tablets. And we gave people very similar tasks to complete, and they were their brain waves were measured through the electrodes. And there's a whole presentation in itself on these slides. But what I'd like to pull out is the stats on the next two, which show that when people were using augmented reality, we saw almost double the engagement and the attention to that subject matter. So it was 95% or visual attention and focus was 95% greater than with traditional media. And on the next slide, really important when it comes to educating people about our brand, our marketing message, or even in learning and development, trying to teach people through doing, we found that memory recall for these tasks was up to 70% higher than compared to the traditional media. And I'll just touch on some of the power or the results that AR can deliver. Because the experience is not just about making our customers smile. It is about delivering a value back to our brands and using the smartphone as the conduit. And this can be measured in a number of ways. You can measure that in pure number of scans, and 14 million scans is what we've delivered through our partners at Danone. We can use that to increase sales at retail. When it comes to data capture, there seems to be a really interesting phenomenon around the propensity to share data, but also opt in to future marketing when the user has had a good experience or is even holding the product in their hand. When we're in the AR experience, we can give consumers or the users a good experience. We can make them smile, we can make them fall in love with the brand, and then they would be prepared to share positive reviews and comments on social. And if the customer has their own app, and we'll touch on 7-Eleven as a good example afterwards, we can embed our scanning components into that app, and that can help us to drive downloads of the app itself. And if you are thinking about commissioning or working on your own AR experience, this is probably the single most important slide out of this presentation. And I'd encourage you to take this out with you. And it really distills down our learnings over the last decade and puts those into what we call our three C's for success. And these are the core pillars by which we assess and evaluate every campaign that we plan and we review. And these are the content, the context that the user is in, the call to action that we've given them, and then the content itself. And to break down into each of those, the context is the user's environment. Think of these as the hygiene factors around scanning. Has the user got time to take the phone out of the pocket and scan? Have they got access to a Wi-Fi network? Is data cheap enough to do that? So if the user is at home, at retail, at work, or on the bus, they're all great context. If the user is driving or maybe on a flight, probably not the best time to try and ask them to scan something and connect to the cloud. Then we need to give them a really compelling and obvious call to action. And these are the simple instructions that tell them that AR content exists and how to get it. So take your phone out, either open an app or open your camera and scan. But the user is only going to do that if the content is either fun, useful, or interesting to them at that point in time. So we have to really be cognizant and mindful of what it is the user is want and how we can help them, and include that in the call to action that should be on the packaging or the poster or whatever it is the user's scanning, but also be backed up through any of your other media channels to reinforce that education. And we'll come on to some of those examples on the next slide. Which is a great example of an omni-channel call to action activated by Carlton Dry in Australia. And they came up with a brilliant slogan to not only promote the campaign, but deliver that call to action. Buy beer, Shazam, get cool stuff. And this was launched during the days when Shazam ran our scanning technology, which unfortunately has ceased now that Apple has, or all advertising activity in Shazam has ceased now that Apple has bought the app. And the concept here is you would buy your beer, open Shazam, and then scan to win competition prizes. And the user would be able to scan the bottle or the box. They would be able to scan point of sale, or they were educated by point of sale in retail. And it was also backed up with digital promotions on social, on their website, and different feeds. So people understood exactly what was happening and how to get it. Now, before we even jump into the fun stuff, the creative elements, it's really important to treat AR like any other, I suppose, business planning process and set your objectives. Ask yourself, what are we trying to do? And what's in it for the brand? And ultimately, we can then get on to what's in it for the user. But through setting up our objectives, here's a range of, I suppose, topics that our partners ask us to help them with. It's not a comprehensive list, but it's a good sample of the most popular ones. And starting at 12 o'clock, we can help to tell brand stories. What sets your product against aside from other products in the market? Have you got a provenance story? Moving clockwise round, a brand purpose is becoming a huge topic at the moment, and as well as CSR. But unfortunately for brands, this is not a topic that most customers are going to actively search and trying to look out. So if you are telling a story through your marketing, your advertising, your packaging, this is a great way to amplify and bring those stories to life. Moving round again, we can inspire brand use. And this is especially important for foods, for drinks, for cosmetics, where we can use tutorials to teach people how to use the products better or in different ways and drive consumption. We can use digital rewards to drive sales, and collecting those rewards can really improve loyalty over the long term. We mentioned the benefit of driving social media from your packaging, as well as collecting data. And that can be anything from cold, hard, first party data, so asking people for their email address, but we can also learn how people are using your product and the frequency. So data doesn't just have to be first party, it can also be usage. And for brands trying to link or deliver their direct to consumer channels, we can help to link those back, those customers back to your e-commerce site to repurchase or cross-purchase products in your range.
Thank you, Martin. So I guess just off the back of that, there's a lot of ways that you can connect with your audience. And audience, again, here implies both from a kind of sales and marketing standpoint, as well as to learners in the education world. So the standard way that you can start using Zapper and augmented reality with us is by downloading the Zapper app. It's free to use. It's available on iOS and Android. And it's a really great way to just get started with augmented reality and getting involved with seeing some great content. If your company has an app already, as is with the case on with 7-Eleven, then what we can do is we can embed our scanning technology into your app, thereby making it an AR-enabled app. So that's a really great way to increase downloads, as Martin was saying earlier. And you know, if you have already a dedicated audience of people who are using your app, it encourages them to use that app even more. The third option on the left there is what we call our white label or our branded scanning app option. And that's where perhaps you want your own dedicated app, but you don't have one. And that's so something that we can build for you. It's essentially like the Zapper app with your branding, your logos, colors, etc. The next step for us is WebAR. And WebAR is a really exciting opportunity because with WebAR, you don't need an app at all. You know, over the last few years that I've been with Zapper, the number of times that people have asked, do you need an app? Is there any way around the app situation? And up until now, we can now finally say, yes, there is a way around having an app, and that's what WebAR is, because rather than using an app, you can now use the browser on your phone, like Safari or Chrome, to actually launch and engage with the augmented reality. There are two ways into any WebAR experience. One is by typing in the URL manually. And as you can see on the screen there, it says, in this specific example, coca-colaafrica-ar.com. So you could type that in, or you can scan a QR code, either using the native camera on your phone, like on an iPhone, for example, when you just open the camera app and scan a QR code, it'll automatically take you to the URL. Some Android devices have the same, and others you need to download a QR code reader. The point is, though, that this significantly reduces the barrier to entry for your intended audience to actually get involved with the augmented reality and seeing the AR content that you've created. And that's really important because if people find it difficult to get into the AR experience, then there's a drop-off point. So it's a really exciting opportunity. We're really excited about it for a number of different reasons. And a lot of our brands are also excited about it. And as you can see here, I mentioned the branded scanning app or embedded option. We can do something similar for WebAR, where we can customize the splash screen that you land on when you first get to your AR experience. And then also the URL at the top. So it's a completely branded WebAR experience. It's great for some of the bigger brands and also some of the smaller brands for whom that brand name and recognition is really important. You can actually try it out here on the screen. So if you just take your iPhone or Android and point it. So again, with the iPhone, you can use just the camera as though you're about to take a picture and point it at the QR code. With Android, on some devices, it's the same, and on others, you may need a QR code reader. This experience is a little simpler. So as you'll see, or if you're not choosing to scan it, what you'll see is basically this image coming to life. So a video will start playing and it's describing, this is for Nespresso, it was at a pop-up event describing their CSR efforts. As Martin was mentioning earlier, that's a very popular and important communication strategy for a lot of corporations. And with this one, what you'll see is this video come to life directly in your browser. So there's no need for downloading the app and scanning the zap code, as some of you may be familiar with. That whole process is gone, and instead you can launch straight into it. We have other examples, not in today's presentation, but we can send to you afterwards of other ways that WebAR can be done that you can test as well. I'm just waiting for a couple more seconds so that people can have the opportunity to scan this. Okay, I'm gonna move on to the next slide now. What's fantastic about augmented reality is, especially like with the previous example, we were looking at a piece of print material that was basically like a poster that was at a pop-up event, as I mentioned. What we're able to do with AR and the QR code and essentially bringing this digital aspect to print media is we're able to get an idea of data, specifically what are people doing with your print pieces. So whether that's packaging or any kind of learning materials or sales, leave behind, the list goes on and on. So you can get an idea of how many people engaged with your content, where, which country are they coming from, which is especially helpful if this is a global campaign of some sort. Other things are, you know, how often do they come back? So you can see unique scans versus total scans. How much time do they actually spend in your AR experience? And also, what elements within the content are they actually interacting with, and which elements are they maybe ignoring? So it's a great way to also correct, course correct. You can start seeing what people are interested in and also which sections perhaps people are less interested in. And that brings me to the evolution of your AR projects. So when creating augmented reality, especially when you're looking at it from a broader time horizon, meaning going beyond just a one-time project, it's a good idea to start with a kind of a crawl, walk, run approach, especially if this is something new for you, for your corporation, for your clients, for your learners, doing almost like a spot test, just seeing, starting with something small and seeing how does this work? You know, how does my audience react to this? Are they finding it interesting? Are they engaging with it? Are they getting involved? And for those, for that first kind of smaller tests, you can get an idea of what's working and what's not. And it allows you to then pivot, test, iterate, make it better. Those analytics are a crucial element of this evolution aspect, because you can see, you know, how many engagements you got, how many engagements did you expect. It's also really helpful to take a further step back and take a look at those three C's that Martin was outlining earlier. How did you, you know, was the context as you expected? How did you implement the call to action? Could it have been done a little bit more maybe in your face, or more with a better explanation of what exactly you're going to achieve and why you should be scanning? And then third is the content. Could we have designed the content any differently? And by taking a look at those three C's and measuring them with your analytics, and by basically doing like a debrief, it becomes easier to try again and to make it better for next time. And that's exactly what creating an AR roadmap in many ways is all about. You're essentially creating a way to plan, you're basically planning out how you're going to be approaching your AR strategy. I think it's important to mention at this stage that AR is, as it says, it's one of the tools that you have in your communications toolbox. It's not necessarily a strategy in its own right. There is going to be certain things that AR is perfect for. There are going to be certain things where AR may not necessarily be a good fit. And it's important for the success of AR to only use AR where it's necessary, because otherwise you can almost dilute its effect and essentially create perhaps a negative user experience if it could have been done better with, let's just say, a YouTube video. So by planning it out ahead of time and thinking, you know, let's say that we're going to break this down, our AR roadmap for the year into four unique experiences. The first one can be one of those smaller ones, like a spot test, as I called it earlier. This is our this is our way to just see what works, what doesn't. The second one is our way to do maybe something similar, not too much bigger, maybe a little bit more involved, using the learnings from the previous experience. The third one is going to be taking even more data and learning from that, making it a little bit more, maybe a little more powerful, a little punchier. And then the fourth one is almost like the grand finale for the year. That could be one way potentially to consider it, whether it's for your marketing strategy or educational strategy. So it's really about taking the time to think about what do I want to do over the course of the year and potentially 2 years. Going back to that wheel, or those, I don't remember how many, there might have been like 9 different points that Martin was going through in the clockwise motion, where you can see here are the various ways that I can use AR, and understanding how can I integrate something like augmented reality into our communications strategy. And from there, then you can pick the right tool for the job from a Zapworks standpoint, whether that's using Zapworks Designer to create some cool video content and getting people interested in seeing maybe a poster come to life, or going into Studio and really digging into the 3D aspect and maybe picking apart products or different services that you offer, or doing some kind of learning scenarios like soft skills. So it's important to, when you think about it from a longer point of view, it becomes less of a one-off thought process, and then each of those modules works together. And by modules, I mean each piece of AR content you create. They work together in unison, and they're able to deliver on the type of goals and ROIs and KPIs that you've set for yourself. So what we'll do now is run through some case studies that we've done. If I'm not mistaken, all of the case studies that we have here were created by our in-house team, and they're all going to illustrate different aspects of what we talked about today in terms of basically thinking about your strategy far in advance and going through it that way. So we'll start with 7-Eleven.
Great. Thank you, Dan. I'm going to, just to emphasize the three C's, I'm going to talk about the case studies in terms of those three C's to understand the context, the call to action, and the content. And where we're allowed due to our NDAs, I'll share some stats along with it. But our first stop is with 7-Eleven. And the reason why I've chosen this is to really illustrate the evolution of AR, to pick up on another phrase we mentioned earlier, away from, campaign-based marketing, so a short-term 4 to 6 week campaign, into what's termed the always-on approach. So we have a 12-month, 365-day-a-year content plan, and are rolling those iterations and those new episodes of content out there to deliver on the overarching objective. So in this context, 7-Eleven wanted to increase their market share amongst their convenience store competitors. And they wanted to drive, as they called it, the trips, taps, and transactions. They wanted to drive trips into store. They wanted to drive engagements with their 7-Eleven rewards app. And they wanted to drive transactions at till. So they created lots of really powerful call to action on the point of sale in store. They had messages inside their app telling people what was available for them in store, and they backed it up with lots of social posts. Now, the content itself was really interesting because they created a 12-month calendar of in-store, I suppose call it trade marketing, which their partners could participate in and create mini games in store. And they understood that their millennial audience were driven by gaming and entertainment. So by creating little bite-sized mini games in store that were scanned through the 7-Eleven rewards app, we could then connect the achievements in those games with actual rewards and monetary rewards in the app and the rewards app itself. So by playing games and sharing on social, I could earn digital points that were translated into discounts at tills. And to pick up on something that Daniel mentioned, they didn't approach this in the first month by saying, we have to have it perfectly executed and we need to have all the answers, all the questions answered immediately. They approached it in a really novel way, and they termed or coined a phrase called minimum delightful product. And I'd encourage you to use that same sort of thought process of creating a product and AR experience that is going to delight your audience and deliver the reaction that you want. But you don't need to have it fully fledged. You can do that over time. You can evolve it, make it better, and react to what you've just learned. So in this context, we had customers coming into store that loved gaming. They could download the 7-Eleven Rewards app and scan point of sale that was around the store to play mini games and win points and discounts at tills. So moving on out of the retail environment, and I think this is really pertinent, this Nespresso example is really pertinent to the unfortunate environment that we're all experiencing at the moment. We are all quarantined. We're all encouraged to stay at home. And actually visualizing products could be a really interesting way to help drive sales through overcoming what we call the imagination gap of what does that product look like in my home. So the context here for Nespresso was trying to help people to overcome that imagination gap and visualize the coffee machine in the homes at real scale. So how is that coffee machine going to look in my kitchen? Is it too big? Is it too small? Do I like that color, or would I like to explore the range? So this campaign was rolled out through direct mail, through leaflets handed out at retail. It was also delivered through online, social, and even email marketing. So it touched all of their channels. And it allowed people to use the camera on their device to place that coffee machine in their real home. And once they chose the right machine for them, they could either take a picture and send it to their partner as a subtle hint for a birthday present, or they could link directly through to the e-commerce platform and make that purchase in the comfort and confidence that they have chosen the exact right one for their environment. And I think given our context at the moment of all being quarantined, this product visualization could be a very powerful tool. So Daniel, if you could move on to the next one. The next one I'd like to pick up on is how, again, thinking about our quarantine environment, is how immersive technology and AR or VR in this case can really drive the performance of direct mail. And in this case, TD Bank, a large bank in the US, did a pilot. So this is going back to Daniel's test and learn approach. they did a pilot for a virtual reality cardboard direct mail piece, where they would send a flat pack cardboard headset to a group of users. And the objective there was to teach people about the bank and some of their unique operations, or the benefits of those operations. And on the top row, you can see that this flat pack piece of cardboard headset was delivered through the post. The user would construct it and drop their phone in, and then be able to immerse themselves in a VR experience that allowed them to either watch videos or play some interactive mini games that brought the different product ranges to life. Now, unfortunately, I can't share the actual results of this, but what we are allowed to share is that the results for this were off the chart. The open rate, the engagement rate, and the conversion rate to contacting the bank was so high that I think the client had to check the figures a couple of times just to make sure they hadn't made a mistake, and that far exceeded anything they had expected or experienced from direct mail, traditional direct mail, whether it be a leaflet or a letter. And I'm delighted to see that immersive direct mail has a place. And maybe, as we're all cooped up in home, we're a little bit more receptive to that sort of messaging. And if we can replicate those off-the-chart stats that TD Bank was suggesting, then it would be an interesting use case to explore.
Moving over to the learning and development side a bit further, this is one that we created for Bupa and Fire Wardens, that are basically, these are people who are nominated within nursing or care homes to ensure that everyone is safe and taken care of if there is a fire at one of these care facilities. The reason why using augmented reality in this specific setting it was so powerful is because otherwise this training was typically delivered in a classroom or with mostly just text. You potentially could have created a video, but overall it would be a relatively boring type of learning experience, just really learning about who do you evacuate from a burning building first. It would be a very kind of theoretical thing that your eyes probably would glaze over as you try to go through the content. So this is something that needs to be, this training needs to be done once a year. And it's something that every year is always a struggle to go through. So what we created for them was essentially this type of experience that actually gets people and the learners out of their seats in order to take a look at how, take a look at what this is actually like in a real scenario. So rather than just reading about it, you can actually do it in real, well, like in a practice run. So it was a multiple step experience. First, you would scan one code that would start a 2-minute countdown with a fire alarm, and you can kind of see that thermometer picture or image on the left. And then from there, there were three different characters that were posted around the facility, and you would scan each one of their codes, just like here we see Mabel, and you would scan each one of those codes to see a little bit more about that individual. So there were three people, Mabel being one of them. Based on the correct choice, you would then evacuate and choose the correct person and take them to a safety area. This whole experience really needed people to actually get out of their seats because these images were posted around the facility. So it became an interactive experience. And if we go back to the Mindshare report and brain activity, that's a significantly more engaging way to teach something. And because of the game element, because there is a time crunch and there is this really annoying beeping sound of the alarm on your device. And there are other people who are also doing this simultaneously. So there's a bit of a competitive aspect to it. You're really getting involved. That's the idea. So beyond that, there's also a strong memory association. So you're able to remember much more easily what you covered, because it's probably a very unique way to do it. From a strategy standpoint, it's quite a brilliant approach, because this is evergreen content. It's something that needs to be done every year, and it's something that the teachers or the instructors struggle to teach on an annual basis. So from that point of view, from a strategic standpoint, you're really thinking ahead about where are the difficult points of communication from me to my audience, and what do I do on a regular basis that could be simplified. So using this approach and picking evergreen content that can be recycled is a really powerful way to approach AR and really any content. This doesn't just go for AR. We know the power of, or many marketers know the power of, evergreen content. And same thing with educational materials in general. So we've talked about examples that Zapper has made for our clients, but we also have a lot of companies that are using the augmented reality tools to create their own AR experiences, either for themselves or for their clients. And it's important to remember that if and when you approach the AR experiences that you're making, to really take it from this bigger picture of, you know, coming up with a strategy, doing the crawl, walk, run approach. Martin mentioned doing basically like test runs and I just blanked on the term, but where you're just testing it out and seeing how it works, a proof of concept. That was the word I forgot. And it's okay to start small. This is a new medium. It's not only is it okay to test, it's also actually, I would say, encouraged, because each audience will respond to it differently. Some audiences love it. Others, it may not be such a great way to do maybe that one specific type of experience that you've provided. So start small, test, iterate, and try again. And what we're saying is, when you commit to going beyond just a one-off campaign, then first of all, you as the end user end up learning a lot more on what works and what doesn't. And also your client starts to learn more on what they like, what they don't like, what works and what doesn't. And combining that, again, going back to the earlier slide with the analytics, you can get pretty much real-time data on what is working and what isn't working. And so we're seeing a lot of this type of, we're seeing a lot of this happening in our community, where a new client joins an agency, let's say, and the agency starts building content consistently for that client by planning out ahead and learning about their use cases and what their needs are, where their pain points are, for example, and then applying a long-term strategy to it. So that's pretty much all the content that we have. We've talked pretty much nonstop for 45 minutes. Hopefully it was really helpful and interesting. So we'd like to open it up now for questions. So Martin and I can go through some of these here. And start answering them. The first question looks like came from Nate Hulley. Hey, Nate. Question was, what are the device limitations that you see for WebAR, and has it impacted engagement? Martin, do you have anything specific? As what I can say is that in terms of device limitations, we always, whenever we create any updates or add any new features and functionalities to, whether it's the app or in this or now WebAR, we always start with the oldest devices and work our way up from there. So our mantra and our ethos as a company is to democratize augmented reality. And so it's really important for us to be able to reach as broad of an audience as possible, which is really important both from a marketing and from an educational or L&D perspective. Currently, WebAR supports pretty much everything that is supported in the Zapper app, except for basically full-scale world or surface tracking. So what's currently off the table basically is, kind of no pun intended actually, is like a portal type experience where you can step inside of a different world. That's not currently available or supported. We recently introduced instant tracking, which allows you to have a lot of the elements of world tracking in WebAR. It just doesn't support things like instant tracking or very large models placed in the world around you. Martin, is there anything you'd like to add to that?
Yes. It's a great, great question, because that does come up in a lot of the WebAR conversations. So a couple of facts just to bear in mind. The native QR scanner is prevalent in iOS operating system 11 upwards and in the Android operating system 9 upwards. And I think in the short term, one of the best elements is to think about the web browser being, it is slightly slower at processing information, and the camera runs at a slower frame rate. So yes, we can do pretty much 80-85% of what's available in the native app, but we should keep the content relatively, I suppose, simpler than through the app. And so examples like complicated face filters may not work as well through through the web browser, but on the whole, I think they are pretty performant. The Zapper platform is getting better at running those, and we're also our tutorials are showing how to overcome some of the web browser shortcomings. And over time, I'm sure the web browsers themselves will improve. As Daniel said, world tracking is currently not available. That is something that we are working on, and also recording within the AR experiences is currently not there. But most other functions, animations, mini games, face filters, they are all performant in WebAR.
Cool. Thank you, Martin. So there's another question from Jonathan Ofori asking, what are the best practices when it comes to UX designing for AR? The way I'm thinking about this is more from a kind of creating good UX within an AR experience. Martin, maybe this one is a good one for you.
So what are the best practices when it comes to UX designing for AR? And I think I would really start with sort of our process of trying to storyboard out the experience first, and in some I suppose I was going to call it PowerPoint note there, but no, Photoshop, and really trying to plot out the whole journey and almost go from wireframe to then a storyboard and then to deliver the then to progress into the build. And I would probably say, think about the amount of space that we all have on the screen, and understand that it's a very limited amount of space, and we need to keep the UX and the UI really simplified so that we leave enough space for the interesting content there. And sometimes that is the recurring theme of just try and keep it simple, but also plan out the different journeys. And I keep coming back to it. Keep it simple, plot out your journey, and remember that AR is that short form bit of infotainment. We're not trying to create a Hollywood epic. We're just trying to give people 1 to 2 minutes of an experience that introduces the topic that you are talking about.
Excellent. Another question came up from Nate's, which is, how did you measure the plus 16% sales for 7-Eleven?
I'll take that one on. That was really done by their analysts. And it's not something that we have access to, because it is really down to their attribution model of measuring lots of different parameters. Yes, they had access to the stats that Daniel spoke about on the near live data analytics page. But no, it was mainly done through their analysts.
Got it. And what was the turnaround time required for the 7-Eleven games?
I suppose if we're doing that through the studio, we generally advise anywhere between 14 and 20 weeks. And that time really depends on the complexity of the project itself, but also the turnarounds and approval times required by the partners. It is not uncommon for some of the entertainment brands to need 10 working days, whereas other partners can turn around feedback overnight. So obviously that complexity and feedback time has an impact on the production schedule.
Great, thank you. There's a few questions regarding tutorials and training. And this is for creating your own AR experiences using the Zapworks tools. We do have tutorials. You can take a look on our documentation page. It's just docs, that's spelled docs.zap.works. And you'll see for our different tools there, which it's broken down by tools. So you can see Studio and Designer tutorials, and we have all sorts of great information on how to create content with those tools there. We also provide training, which is great for which is great for people who want to get kickstarted with using the Zapworks tools, and that's a one-to-one approach with one of our members of from our support team. We have multiple modules that you can use. We basically take different functionalities within Designer and within Studio and break them down into bite-sized chunks about an hour long each. And then we basically teach you not just how it works, but why it works and why it's done in the way that it's done. And that way you can take those skills and apply them to creating your own AR experiences. Normally, we offer that training in person. We can either, typically, we can either come to you or you can come to our offices in London. Unfortunately, that's not really an option now. So we also offer doing the training via screen share. And if you're interested in learning more about that, please let us know and we can let you know more details there. Let's see, another question is, let me just see here. Sorry, just reading through everything. Looks like
there are quite a few questions around tutorials, which seems to be a very popular topic in the chat as well. Mm-hmm. So refer everybody to that. docs.zap.works, and there's that good mixture of written and video tutorials there. Somebody specifically called out the solar system. And Daniel, do you know whether we've got a tutorial around that?
Yes, it's less of a step-by-step tutorial per se and more of a project breakdown, as we call it, where the project was built and basically a member of our support team walked through kind of in general the steps and the thought process behind creating that project. We have a couple more, if I'm not mistaken, project breakdowns as well. We do not currently have a step-by-step tutorial for the mini solar system project. That being said, we can offer the basically the skills required to build the mini solar system in a training session with our support team member. We've actually already delivered something similar to that to a ZapWorks client in the past, and they really enjoyed it and got a lot of value from it. I saw a question earlier about WebAR and really what is kind of how does that work? So when you, or specifically when you scan a QR code, and I guess the answer to that is that the QR code will take you to a landing page, meaning it will take you to a website in the browser. What we're able to do is we're able to make the Zapper augmented reality technology available in the browser. So when you open up a website, then you can see the AR directly in there. So it doesn't open the app per se. And yes, Francois is saying that the web browser is really the selling point for your clients. Exactly right. We agree. It's really a great way to get involved because there is no app download. It just makes it so much easier to encourage those scans and to encourage those engagements. So on that note, we're a couple minutes over. We will answer the questions online, or sorry, offline. I'm afraid we need to end our call here. So thank you again very much for your time. I hope this was helpful. If you have any questions, please reach out to us. You can always send an email to contact@zapper.com. And if you just mentioned that you were part of the webinar, then we'll be able to filter for your questions and make sure that we're answering them with that context. So thank you again, and talk to you soon.
Take care. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.